Good morning and a very warm welcome back to Morning Express. We're glad you're watching on this Tuesday. It is time for Person of Interest, and joining me this morning is Cord Co-Principal. He's also the Senate Minority Leader, also Bungoma Senator, the Ford Kenya Party Chairman, or Party Leader if you like, and as well as a prominent lawyer in the country. I hope I've mentioned them all. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
And I'm sure very many other things that you perhaps get to tell us as we go along. We're glad you could join us on the program today, Person of Interest.
Thank you.
So let's begin, before we get to the politics and all the other things, to get a little bit to know more about Senator Wetangula. Growing up, where did you grow up? Where did you go to school?
It's a long story. I was born in Bungoma.
Yeah.
In a village called Muhwea, in Nalondo Division, Bungoma Central, Bungoma County. I went to school to several schools within the county, which I'm very proud of. Primary school, I went to Nalondo Primary School, which is now a big secondary school. I went to Teremi Secondary School, which I did my Form 1 to 4, and thereafter I went to the mighty Friends School Kamsinga, which is one of the top schools in the country, and thereafter joined the University of Nairobi.
And all this while, you had set your sights on politics?
Politics came in a little later, but I was a practitioner of what I would call pseudo-politics in my formative years, very avid and active member of debating clubs in school, part of the student leadership in schools, in terms of either prefecture or class monitor. The University of Nairobi were engaged in very active political discourses at the Great Court and so on. So it has always been there, but public engagements, sometimes private activities that involve maybe looking at what you need to do for the family, for yourself. It's a loaded day on an average, and I like it because being busy is better than being idle.
How do you unwind? Other than maybe with the workouts, do you play golf, hang out with friends? What is the downtime for you?
I have never had an eye for golf. A lot of my friends play golf. I generally find golf an extremely time-consuming game.
Really?
And you need plenty of time. I wouldn't call it idle time, but time to spare.
It's also good for a workout, the walk.
Yes, I'm told the walk is very refreshing. But since I have alternative ways of working out, I don't need to load myself with too many things.
Yes.
But I have many, many friends, politicians, whom on an average, again, you retreat to sit and reflect on the day, look at what is coming. Look at what we have been doing, how we've been doing, and how better we can make it. Remember, we have our eyes on the ball, and we must keep our eyes on the ball by continuing to network, continuing to compare notes, and to see how what we haven't done well, we can do better when we try again.
Before we get into the current affairs, I remember there was also another plane incident other than, you know, that health scare, over your identification. And I think we have a clip just to maybe sort of help us clarify whether it was all settled, because I remember at the time, I think you'd indicated you'd sue, and KQ had maintained that they were just following their practices. We have that clip. Maybe we can run it and then get to hear what the senator has to say. Let's take a listen.
I was embarrassed and humiliated by our national carrier.
Bungoma Senator Moses Wetangula, who is also the leader of minority in the Senate, was a troubled man last night. According to Wetangula, he had arrived at the Jomo Kenyatta International Airport with fellow lawmakers for a flight to Mombasa. After being cleared, he was issued the boarding pass and proceeded to board the flight destined to Moi International Airport, Mombasa. He was in the company of Parliament Speakers Ekwe Ethuro and Justin Muturi and a host of other parliamentary colleagues. Suddenly, Wetangula says the aircraft was grounded and everyone evacuated on what the airline staff claimed was a security threat. The airline staff demanded that Wetangula should be ejected from the plane. Wetangula says he explained that he forgot to pick his ID from the traveling bag, which his driver and security officer had driven with to Mombasa.
Right. So we've cut short the report, of course, because we remember the details. But yes. What happened thereafter?
I instructed my lawyers to look into the matter. Mm-hmm. And in the process, some friends who are in the management of the airline called me and spoke to me. And I also felt, you know, as a leader, sometimes we go through these things. Mm-hmm. Certainly the airline staff treated me very poorly and shabbily. And many people have, with, I believe, malice, been making all manner of comments that I demanded that I should be known. I never did any such thing. Mm-hmm. That I told the girls at the airport they should know people. I cannot say such a thing. Mm-hmm. All I didn't have is my ID because it had gone with my bag in my car, and I had alternative
identification
documents, including Kenya Airways Platinum Card, which is the most, the highest level of commitment to any airline you can have.
Yeah.
And with a Platinum Card, if the girls who are pursuing that humiliation towards me wanted to know, is you just plug it into your computer and the entire details of your customer come on screen.
So the dispute was settled, you did not
I didn't go to court, and I won't go to court, and I hope they don't treat people that way, because identification is about additional information about a person you don't know well. This girl kept on telling me, "Honorable Wetangula, you must get out," which means she knew me. So what more identification did she want when she knew who I was and she was addressing me as such?
Okay.
I found it very strange.
Yeah. What has been your highest moment in life so far? The moment in your life so far you feel that was a great highlight?
Oh, many, many highlights. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can count on and on. After my high school,
at a personal level, away from politics,
when I achieved my entry to the university to study law, I thought that was my highest level, because during those days when you did your A levels, you choose three careers at the university, mm-hmm. which one in order of priority you want, and I had chosen first choice law, second choice law, third choice law. And when I was...
So for you it was all about law?
It was all about law, yes.
By whatever way.
When I was selected to go to study law, and those days, you know, it was very prestigious because your names would be published in the media, we were fewer, and we were very well networked, schools were fewer, and so on. So that was very nice.
What about lowest?
My lowest moment in life... again, it's multiple. When I lost my grandmother, I was very low because I grew up in her house and she was like my mother. And
where were your parents?
My parents were there, but you know, in our community, children choose, as it were, depending on their favorite relatives and live with them.
Where you stay
of from? Course, times have changed because of harsh economic realities. But in those days, I grew up in the house of my grandmother. And when my grandmother passed on, I felt really low.
It shook you.
It shook me. And thank God, I now have children named after my grandmothers.
Keeping
and,
her alive.
I feel they are alive and around me.
Yeah.
My grandmothers, one called Pauline, another one called Sophia.
Ah, yes. Sophia.
Yes.
Yeah, beautiful name. It means wisdom, did you know?
Absolutely, yes.
Okay, that's great. Thanks for sharing with us a part of you so that we at least get an insight of away from the politics and the statements.
And of course, perhaps I should mention that I love farming.
Oh, do you?
I, from my youth, have been a very avid, not big farmer, but with tremendous interest in keeping poultry, small family animals, goats, sheep, pigeons.
Nice.
Even today, if you come to my residence, you'll find guinea fowls, you'll find geese, you'll find lots of chicken, you'll find dairy cattle. And of course, I do a bit of maize farming. And
so for you, is it subsistence or is it commercial?
One would love it to be commercial, but management is a problem because when you entrust a third party to manage some things for you, they never do well. So you turn it into a sort of hobby.
Yeah.
And believe that if any proceeds come out of it, well and good. If mm-hmm. it doesn't, so be it.
Mm.
Yes.
So the Morning Express team will wait for chicken and we can have a
Ingo
party with Ingo.
You will love it. It's our delicacy. Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
All right. Let's get to some of now those stories we've been covering, a lot of which, of course, touch on your coalition. And the statement you gave the other day, issued alongside Kalonzo Musyoka, on this land in Taita Taveta that has been linked to the Kenyatta family. So you had asked that the alleged renewed lease be reversed mm-hmm. by the NLC. And now mm-hmm. we have the NLC chair, Swazuri, coming out to say that that had not happened even in the first place. Mm-hmm. So are you also going to backtrack on your words, seeing that they've announced that there was no such thing that happened?
You know, there is something tragically wrong happening in the management of our land in this country. Mm-hmm. The land policy, the land management, the record keeping, and so on. Before I even come to the Taita Taveta, I can give you an example. You remember some time back, the Minister for Lands, the Honorable Charity Ngilu, mm-hmm. Distinguished lady in the politics of this country, announced that she had closed down the registries of Nairobi, Mombasa to streamline records, to make sure files are back on the shelves, mm-hmm. and issues of files disappearing were going to be history. A month later or so, she appears before a parliamentary committee when they were investigating the 134-acre carried land issue.
Mm-hmm.
And she startles everybody by saying she's not able to find the records of that land. So why had she closed down the registry? Ostensibly to streamline land records.
Mm.
And suddenly, a matter that had been in dispute and in public domain for 2 weeks, and she turns up and says she can't find the records. That is what has been making some of us say that the reasons for her unilateral and unlawful closure of the registries was more than just trying to streamline the records. Mm-hmm. We believe that they were probably trying to do something much more sinister than that. But come to the Taita Taveta land, which came as a collateral, as it were, to the Langata land grab, mm-hmm. which is again a big issue for the last 2-3 weeks. The source of information that the lease had been renewed was the chairman of the National Land Commission. He's the one who not only said he had renewed the lease, but went on to say something totally unsolicited, that the family of the president does not own half of the county.
It's
but
just 30,000
It's only 30,000 acres.
Yeah.
And you know, when you're talking in a country where people suffer landlessness and live in points, and you refer to 30,000 acres as only, it's nothing. First, it was in very bad taste. Secondly, when a person of that level makes a statement of that magnitude, everybody is bound to believe him.
Mm.
And for us, as the alternative leadership in the country, we said, fine, you may very well renew the lease of anybody who owns land.
Mm-hmm.
But the new constitution has brought new values, new expectations, and new demands that when momentous decisions like this are made, public must participate. And I do know for a fact that the people of Taita Taveta County are extremely pissed with the land that is owned by non-indigenous people in their midst. The people there scrounge for hardly a quarter an acre to put up their family dwellings and so on.
So do you think it's because of your demand that this having be open to public participation that then we're seeing the chair rescinding his decision?
I personally don't believe that the chair is being generous with the truth on this matter. Because why did he say he had renewed the lease without anybody prompting him? And why is he now saying he hasn't renewed without showing the public that this is the old lease, this is how it was given?
He's quoted in the Daily today as having said he's actually not sure of all the details.
Look at that. Yes, I read that mm-hmm. as I was sitting waiting to come in. And when the custodian of a constitutional office interest such as that is not sure of what he's talking about, in particular in a matter of such contention, because we have been saying that a few families in this country, including the president's family, own inordinate and obscene chunks of land at the expense of many poor people, and this should be addressed. The National Land Commission should be telling Kenyans what policies they want to put forward to solve this, instead of running up and down, to and fro, helter-skelter, telling us they have renewed the lease, they haven't renewed the lease. I have reason to believe that probably the backtrack on the renewal of the lease is because of some arm twisting somewhere.
Okay. Allegations that have not been substantiated.
Yes.
Still on land, the other day the CS Ngilu announced a number of names, individuals believed to be behind the Langata land grab. Yeah. Across the board there seems to have been, you know, skepticism over whether these are really the individuals behind the same. Do you share in that, or do you believe this largely the same? We had quite a number of
You remember what the Minister Ngilu said before she dropped those names? She said she was going to give the name behind the names.
Yes, and she reported that.
Yes, she was reported to have said that, and I have reason to believe she said it. Then she gave the names. Now we're waiting for the name behind the names.
Okay.
Which she hasn't given.
So do you think there's another name?
I'm sure there is. Definitely there is. And we know who it is. We have simply exercised restraint in not saying who it is, but we know who it is.
But is it because you don't have evidence to prove? Because remember, on the Karen land issue, your part of your membership went ahead and named an individual and then was sued and appeared not to
have
evidence.
Well, I was not part of the
you are not
the
part
team,
of
but
it
was my court team.
Yes.
And they have definitely facts to defend themselves successfully in court, and I'm sure they will.
So you're
in
not
this particular case, you know very well that there is a hotel next to the school playground. We know who owns the hotel. There's some impostor who has come forward claiming that he owns the hotel. We know he doesn't. We know who owns the hotel. And we know how the hotel land was acquired. In fact, there is a big question on how that hotel land was acquired, and it's before a parliamentary committee. So rules of parliament may not permit me to discuss that matter beyond what I've said, but there's a matter before a committee of parliament questioning how the parcel of land on which the hotel stands was acquired. And we have been told that...
So if you know, why are you not coming forward with this information? Because some other people claim to know that it's clear, but everyone is just knowing, and then the situation in life is
This information is in public domain. There are clips of videos doing the rounds showing, for example, the deputy president inspecting the construction of the hotel and showing how it should be
He'd
done.
He'd argue
and
he
so
was doing
on
it at
so
a friend's land.
Whose friend? Let him
the
say
The man
so.
Who's come out to say he owns
We know that man, and we know he doesn't own the hotel.
So now that you know
we
that,
live
where
in
is
this
that
country.
Evidence? Why don't you give we that to the members of the public who do not have that
I am
that
not litigating on any matter.
Okay.
I am speaking
But
from
you are politicians.
I'm speaking
elected
from
by Kenyans.
A position of public interest. When I speak from a position of public interest, I bring information and put it at the disposal of the public.
But when
and
it's
public,
not backed up,
and
then
the
it doesn't
public
help.
Will pick it up and use it or disregard it. As to this matter of the land along Langata Road, as a leader in this country, in CORD and my party and in the Senate, I do not have the legal instruments to revoke a land title. Those are vested elsewhere, in the National Land Commission.
But you could, as you claim to have evidence, you could submit the same to these bodies that then are charged with that kind of responsibility.
You do not say and submit what is obvious. The Minister for Lands knows this. The
obvious to you,
the National Land Commissioner knows this.
Okay.
The school at Langata, even little kids, that's why they brought down that wall. They knew that a land grab was on the prowl against their playground. That's why they rose.
But isn't that simply politicizing matters, Senator, before we move on? Because when you say everybody knows this, it is just becomes part of dialogue that everybody will have. But at the end of the day, then nothing is done because people will talk about it and move on. But if you truly have information or this evidence to prove otherwise, why not bring it forward in the interest of this public that you say you are representing?
We live in a political setup. Whether a matter is said by a politician or a non-politician, there is always this conclusion that we are politicizing the matter. In fact, we are not politicizing anything, we are being factual. One, we have said it's immoral to take away a playground from school children. Number two, it is immoral for people to distinguish themselves as land grabbers and be on the prowl everywhere. Scouting for any empty land. Three, we are saying there is some degree of unacceptable incompetence in the management of our land system, both at NLC and the ministry, where, for example, I can tell you, if you see a minister for lands going to climb, a lady going to climb over a wall to demonstrate that she's working, then something is wrong somewhere. Because a minister is supposed to sit, design, and execute policy and have people working under her or him to do the job. But when you see a lady being helped to climb over a wall, ostensibly to demonstrate to the public that she's working to recover stolen land, it flies in the face of reason.
Do you think there's political will to deal with the mess in land in Kenya?
There is no political will. I don't see it. And I don't think anybody is interested in solving many of these land problems.
So
for example, when Swazuri said that he had renewed the 30,000 acres of land for the president's family and went on to justify how small it was, one would have expected a conscious president to come forward and comment about it because he knows how contentious this matter is. He's kept a studious silence on the matter. He won't say, he won't see, he won't do. And we know he will not because of vested interests. We can count many examples all over where land issues are so contentious. People have been killed, people have been maimed, people have been dispossessed. And we continue behaving as if it's business as usual.
It definitely is an emotive issue in this country. You want to get into power. What is the alternative you're offering? How would you, if you're in power tomorrow, sort out the mess? And also link that to the fact that it is one of the issues that is or was in your referendum push, which we will perhaps get to get an update on its status.
I know that as CORD leadership, and even I as an individual seeking to lead this country at some point in time, I have my own very strong feelings and ideas about land reform, agrarian reform, land tenure system that we believe will make Kenya more equitable, more acceptable as a country to both our investors internally and externally and Kenyans at large. As to the details of this, is that is our card for the next contest. We cannot start giving our competitors
ideas.
Good ideas that will make them look good when we know they are not looking good at all.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. I'll get your thoughts as well quickly before we go to CORD as the coalition. Alfred Keter, Nandi Hills Member of Parliament.
Yes.
I'm sure by now you've watched
the clip.
I did.
Yes.
What do you think about what happened and that he's refused to apologize?
Very unfortunate. He's a young man I had tremendous liking and respect for, and I think I still respect him because he's been very
vocal.
Not just vocal, but speaking sense all the time, most of the time. The clips I saw at Gilgil, he's saying that he doesn't tell the whole story, but the little I saw, if it is the story, then it's most unfortunate and was totally unnecessary and unhelpful, both to himself and the lady MP that they were with, because many times many of us as leaders get ourselves into situations of that nature, and those words that were uttered and captured are not words that I would expect to come from the mouth of a leader. But since the matter is under investigations and he's alleging that that is not the whole story, I don't want to say I'm giving him the benefit of doubt, but I want to keep an open mind to hear what the investigations will bring forward. If what we had is all that happened, then he certainly owes Kenyans and the officers at that toll station an apology.
Yeah.
If there is much more than that, then let's wait and hear.
What will unfold?
What will unfold?
Also,
but
yeah.
Certainly at the heart of all this is the question of management of our highway toll stations and so on, which are really not very well done and not well managed, because I use road travel a lot and I see a lot of corrupt transactions going on, money changing hands publicly and so on. So as to whether there was corruption being consummated at the time or not, I don't know, but I know there's definitely a lot of underhand dealings. Along those highway spots.
Okay. And then there's Narok, a situation unfolding there. Two deaths reported yesterday, others injured, pitting the government against the senator and other local leaders. What do you make of what's happening over
there? It is a very unfortunate incident. The governor of Narok and my colleague, the senator of Narok, can do things better. In fact, they had opted to do things in a more sensible and legal manner than what I'm seeing unfolding now, because after this event in your studio, I sit in a committee of parliament that is in fact entertaining a hearing of a petition from Narok against the governor. Tomorrow we'll be hearing the governor himself again in response to that petition. And the issues I saw being talked about in the news media, print and electronic, about what happened in Narok are exactly the same that are coming before the Senate. So what I fail to understand is how you choose to take an avenue that is lawful and arbitrative and then degenerate back into taking alternative means that may be an affront to the law and may cause discomfort and breach peace and security. I don't want to pass judgment because the matter is coming before us and
okay.
We'll deal with it.
We'll deal
but
with it.
The situation is unfortunate, it's unnecessary, it's uncalled for, and I want to encourage the governor of Narok, Governor Tunai, whom I know well, and Stephen Olendutu, who has been my colleague for a very long time, and all the MPs of Narok to think of the people they ought to serve other than self-interest and come together and lower the temperatures that we see. Narok is
okay.
A very promising county.
All right.
Remember, it's the home of the only wonder of the world that Kenya hosts, the Maasai Mara. And when such things happen, even in Narok town, they can easily impact very negatively to the operations in the Maasai Mara.
So we'll wait to see how that particular story unfolds as they come before Parliament.
Yeah.
But let's talk about the CORD Coalition of Reforms on Democracy and the politics therein.
Yeah.
But those that have felt, analysts looking at this coalition, that ODM is a dominant, that Ford Kenya and Wiper are the underdogs, and that you do not consider yourselves as equal partners, although you constantly will come out and say you're each equal partners as the principals in this coalition. Is Ford Kenya really an equal partner in CORD?
You know, in a structured relationship as like that, one has to look at much more than the issue of whether one is stronger or weaker. We have a partnership and a political coalition called CORD. CORD brings us together as ODM, Ford Kenya, Wiper, and there were several other less visible parties, federal party that I don't see much anymore. They have one senator in the Senate who acts against CORD and so on. And we have also others. He's the senator for Tana River.
Okay.
Came on federal party, which is an affiliate member of CORD, but Right, his first distinguished activity in the Senate was to betray code by voting against our candidate for speaker, but it's now history. We in code see ourselves as a partnership.
Mm-hmm.
And I think for us to start segmenting ourselves as to who is bigger, who is stronger, is unhelpful. Unhelpful to the extent that even the weakest link can be the strongest link, and the strongest link can be the weakest link in any formation.
Let me hold you to that.
Yes.
In as far as the strongest link, or what could be perceived as the strongest appearing, being the weakest and vice versa,
yes.
ODM is perceived to be the strongest link. But in the recent past has had quite a number of unfortunate incidents, some violent, from nominations to the ejection of Magere, in terms of elections, remember also February last
mm-hmm.
year. So
mm-hmm.
quite a number of those that have had many questioned democracy in
yes.
ODM. So would you say for ODM is one that appears to be the strongest link, but it actually fact is the weakest link in this coalition?
I speak not for ODM, but I can speak for COD and
yes.
for Kenya. ODM is the single largest political party in Kenya today. Whether you are comparing it with the URP or TNA, it is the single largest party in the country. And large parties, or like large institutions, also always have their own challenges in holding together, in managing the affairs. But I think the cohesion in ODM is still something that we cherish and we think is important for COD. We want to encourage them that the failed national elections at Kasarani and the happenings at Homa Bay during the nominations are things that no party would want to embrace as a modus operandi, and the things that I have personally discussed with my brother Raila and told him the party should shed off the tag of that nature. Then you have Wiper, which you saw over the weekend. They had a meeting and they're trying to also face their challenges. There's not a single entity in this country that doesn't have challenges.
So,
even
yeah.
you yourself in life have challenges.
So Wiper, you
when you have challenges, you
yeah.
face them, you deal with them, you sort them out.
So in that meeting you're mentioning, Wiper, some people came up, were donning T-shirts written, I think it was Kalonzo 2017, The Journey
yes.
Begins.
Yes.
So we're seeing him putting house in order, I set on 2017, Odinga and Co as well in ODM.
Yes.
What about yourself?
I have said this before, and let me repeat it for the record. Before we went to 2012-2013 elections, I was a presidential candidate declared. So was Kalonzo. So was Raila. We subordinated ourselves to a common good and formed CORD and fronted our brother Raila as our candidate.
Mm-hmm.
And then Kalonzo became running mate, and I took a position to go and be the majority leader in case we got the majority. The alternative was minority where
mm-hmm.
I am. That was for 2012-2013. 2017 is a different ballgame. None of us has thrown in the towel in our ambitions to become president. Raila still wants to become president. I want to become president. Kalonzo wants to become president.
And some would argue, since he already had a run in 2013, that
yes.
now it should be up to you or Kalonzo. So in the event he still is
yes.
the one to take, and you know, perhaps whatever mechanism you lose, I guess you
yes.
will not be telling us that.
Yes.
Will you then decide to jump ship, or will you again subordinate your ambition to his?
We are looking for good things for this country. If you may look back after elections, you'll always find that most political groupings or coalitions, immediately after elections, if they win elections, they start wrangles as to who is being unfair to who. You've even seen, even with the facade of unity that you're seeing within Jubilee,
JAP.
Behind the curtain, there is a lot of jostling and backstabbing that we know is going on. And There is one thing they are being shortchanged, one thing they are being unfair to each other and so on. For us, when you do not take power, the temptation to break up is even higher. Everybody wants to go their way. Code has held on admirably well. In fact, it is not just in this country, but if you look at comparable jurisdictions within the African continent and beyond, most political formations that come together to pursue an electoral contest disintegrate immediately after the outcome. We have stuck together and we're still together.
But I want
to tell you this,
yes,
that we have no automatic candidate in court.
So in the event,
each one of us is a candidate,
is equal,
and a mechanism will be worked out. In fact, we have our teams that are thinking through to advise us on the best way of arriving at a consensus or a contest that will give us a candidate.
So whatever that mechanism eventually will turn out to be, in the event Raila ends up to be the candidate, or say Kalonzo, will you be...
Or me.
Or no, look. Well, to my question, will you be willing, in the event it's either of the two, to subordinate your ambition? Or will you seek to still go for the presidency?
I think all the three of us have fairly good democratic credentials.
Yes.
You remember Raila saying Kibaki Tosha when he was himself a contestant. You remember Kalonzo agreeing to become a running mate, and I agreed to play the role I played in the last elections. We believe, rather I believe, that our credentials to that extent melted towards the direction of each one of us knowing that yes, I have a personal ambition, so does Raila, so does Kalonzo, but we also have a country to
so
look at.
So in short, you'd be willing to?
We, as long as we have a mechanism that will arrive at a decision that is fair, free, democratic, open, and just.
Although others,
then such a decision has to be respected, because
you'll be
actually an antithesis of democracy if you participate in a contest and then when it doesn't work in your favor, it becomes a case of sour grapes and
right. As it is widely believed, so many times in these mechanisms, it all boils down to what each candidate brings on the table. And when the three of you are put out there, Raila, Kalonzo, and yourself, Raila would be perceived to bring most on the table. Let's look at your base, for example. In terms of the Western Kenya politics, it's been disintegrated for a very long time. Efforts to bring that consolidate a vote-rich area have failed so far. Just the other day, I was reading an article that there are new efforts to form this Lutesa, Luhya, Teso, Sabaot, to just try and bring all of this, consolidate that base to back one candidate and, you know, have perhaps more bargaining power. So do you see yourself bringing enough to the table even at the end of the day?
I can tell you, like they say in the film industry, watch this space.
Okay. How do you consolidate Western Kenya?
The people of Western Kenya have little difficulties in getting consolidated and in standing together.
Really? Then why
hasn't
it worked so far?
The problem has been, in fact, your historical facts may be incorrect. If you may look back at 2002, Western Kenya, under the leadership of Wamala Kijana, voted for NARC en masse, the only seat in the entire Western region that we didn't win as NARC was Nambale, which was won by KANU, Chris Okemo. Everything else went to NARC.
One would argue the politics of 2002 are rather different from what
came
we're looking at last year, but why?
No. The dynamism of politics must be looked at in totality, because if you isolate each incident from the other, then you'll not have the aggregate of what you're looking for. Came 2007, the bulk of the people of Western admittedly voted for Raila Odinga.
And those of us,
who stood with Musalia was not a candidate at that time. He was
Oh, that's for 2013.
In 2013, Again, the majority of Western voted for Raila, the
but
formation in which I was.
Vote, it's a rich basket.
I can tell you this.
So you're not managing to get all of these votes in one. The questions of voter
apathy. I have every hope.
Yeah.
In fact, I'm very optimistic that come the next elections, the people of the Mlembe Nation will put their votes in one basket. But that is not the big picture. The big picture is how do we, as the Mlembe Nation, join up with other like-minded nations of this country to bring change that is meaningful, that is helpful, that is beneficial.
Are you in support of this Lutesa?
Well, Lutesa is nothing new. This is something that has been there for the last 10 years. As to whether Luyas, Tesos, and Sabaots can vote together and work together. There are times we have voted together, there are times we haven't voted together. I have no reason to doubt that the agenda is good, is positive, and anything that brings the people of this country together, I will support, as long as it is not balkanizing the country the way I see Jubilee regime trying to mismanage the ethnic diversity of this country by being narrow-minded and inward-looking.
How so?
If you look at since they came into power, they have literally excluded communities from mainstream leadership of this country. Even when...
But is this a problem brought on by Jubilee, or is it an issue that has been there historically? And the PSC chair was arguing the other day as they released the results of the composition in public service. It's one they're trying to rectify now.
Those compositions by the PSC chair are fraudulent, they're dishonest, and they're totally, totally lacking in what I would call... The real issues that affect this country.
Okay.
You cannot go to a community like the Luya and pick 100 Tigals and 100 watchmen employed manually by the government and compare them to 10 managing directors from another community and say, you see these Tigals represent a much higher percentage in public employment than those with 10 managing directors. You can't compare oranges with apples or compare apples with mangoes. You must compare like with like. Who runs a public enterprise in this country that are quasi-government? Look at even cabinet, how it is set up. And my brothers Uhuru and Ruto have simply sat down and say, where the minister is from your community, the peers will be from mine, and vice versa. And you can count on and on. I mean, it's open. Everybody knows.
Okay.
And what we've been saying is this kind of management of public affairs breeds exclusion. Exclusion breeds resentment. Resentment can degenerate into rebellion. And rebellion can culminate and graduate into something more nasty, which we don't want our country to go through. Because we have seen examples in other countries where exclusion has led the country towards a cul-de-sac and an abyss that has taken time to recover. And yet, you know, we believe that the new generation of leaders, those independence struggle leaders, had a different philosophy. This new generation of leaders who have grown up in independence Kenya, one would expect that they do not look at the country with ethnic blinkers, but unfortunately that is what's happening.
All right, let's
and
talk.
It is not right for the country.
Yeah, let's talk referendum. Months back it was the each topic, a wash all in terms of front page headlines would all be about
Saba Saba
and all of that. Today, you'd imagine there was never any such thing. What happened?
You know, the media, which has been very good to us in terms of bringing out what we are doing. You thought I was going to condemn the media? I do not.
I was waiting
Usually we get quite the shelf. because the media does, like I've said many times, I have been a victim of misreporting, I've been misquoted, I've been misanalyzed, I've been abused. But I'll still always put my neck on the block for the media because I believe you have a very critical role in telling us what is going on. That's why my coalition is in court, and as a lawyer, I'm part of the team defending the people of Kenya against the draconian legislation that the Jubilee regime brought to Parliament, among other things, to muzzle the media. If that law was in place, Kenyans probably would never have known what was going on at Langata Road Primary and many other places.
Okay.
We support the media. Now, what I was saying is this, that yes, the crescendo towards the apex of referendum push came up to Saba Saba, then we started the process, and the process is ongoing. What we didn't want to do, and I think rightly and sensibly so, was we had announced to the country what we want to do. We had laid down what the Constitution and the law requires us to do. Frame the questions, take them to IEBC, collect signatures. When you are collecting signatures, you don't need the hullabaloo and the noises and the rallies that go with the actual campaigns.
Mm-hmm.
I can tell you that on the 2nd of next month, our committee of experts is presenting to us the draft bill towards the referendum as the principals and our teams, which we look at. Once we approve that, then we now start the actual campaign for referendum.
Okay.
Remember, we have to win a minimum of 24 county assembly voting yes for us to move to the to bring the bill back to Parliament.
Right.
So we are now putting on our dancing shoes, as it were, if the Beatles are.
So it's the lull before the storm.
Yes, the
it's
Beatles
coming.
Said, "Put on your dancing shoes."
Yes.
We are waiting to put on our dancing shoes, and we get onto the track.
So, following the unfortunate death of Fidel, we saw also the calls of dialogue being reignited. But a Jubilee, with to some quarters, accused CORD of yes, calling for dialogue on one hand, but on the other, issuing ultimatums and conditions on which this dialogue would happen. Where has that is also appears to have fizzled away?
I don't know which conditions these are. I've been reading that as well.
Well, one of them that was said is I had the Kalonzo say in one, I think, forum that if they do not agree to dialogue, then we are going to continue with the referendum. So perhaps
that is not a condition, because the referendum is ongoing. So when you say we want dialogue, in the absence of dialogue, we'll go on with our referendum.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a condition? It isn't. It is a process that is ongoing. What we have said is that there are things in this country that have been happening that cannot be left to either CORD or Jubilee, that need us to come together, build a national psyche, a national consensus, and a national direction that can help the country. You saw when this country faced serious security challenges that are not over yet, but there was something that was worrying. What were we seeing? Instead of us coming together to close ranks and say, what is happening, how do we deal with it? You saw how everybody, including the head of state, were just throwing words around without caution. Mpeketoni happens. They say it is CORD that has done it. Something else happens. They say it's so. Look at an example of the state of Israel. When Israel is under security threat, you can never tell who is government and who is opposition. Everybody comes together. Everybody speaks with one language. Everybody speaks the language of security and peace for our people.
So why didn't we see you speaking the same language?
We have been demanding, requesting, appealing that we come together, sit down and talk.
We had the president saying, yes, let's talk. He said it. So why haven't you talked?
The
since?
President said, let's talk.
Mm-hmm.
Did he follow it with an attempt to talk? These were just populist statements made before an audience that was necessary to make to. Because if the president is the head of state, he has all the trappings of state machine. If he wants to say to meet us and talk about the country, he doesn't even have to announce it at a requiem mass. He doesn't have to announce it at a roadside. He can pick the phone, this is a colleague we have worked with, we have been in cabinet with, we have been in politics with, we have been in parliament with.
So this dialogue, he can pick. In your view, should work how? He calls, says, Wetangula, Odinga, Kalonzo, come to my office.
He doesn't have to call us personally.
Okay.
There's a system. He doesn't even have to call me. I have an office functioning. Kalonzo has an office functioning. Raila has an office functioning. Mm-hmm. It will take no time to set up a meeting. We cannot be talking at each other at funerals. Let's sit down and say, look, what are issues that we think in this country mm-hmm. require all our participation and input? What are things that are purely Jubilee and we let you fry yourselves in them? What are things that are purely code and you let us fry ourselves in and we'll go to the public to judge whether we did them rightly or wrongly? Mm-hmm. There are such issues. And it is not enough to say, niko tayari kuongea na kila mutu. We are not kila mutu, we are leaders. And for heaven's sake, if you want to talk to us, we are available. If you don't want to talk to us, we have no shortage of what to do in politics of this country.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right. I want to go through some of the questions. There's quite a number of tweets that have come through, many people asking questions. Duncan Mushiri says, is asking something about the Bomet Governor Isaac Ruto in protest together with that of Bomet Governor accused of being government spies. What do you think of his politics, by the way, Governor Ruto? This question is...
Well, Governor Ruto is someone I've known for some time. He's a very outspoken and fearless leader. Mm-hmm. And he occupies a position of representation for his colleagues. And I would want him to... do what he continues doing by speaking on behalf of his fellow governors. I know that he doesn't seem to read on the same page with his colleagues in his party, URP, but that is not for me. It's neither here nor there for mm-hmm. me. I wish him well. I think he's a good governor. I think he's a good politician.
Mm. Yes. What do you see opposition's role being in governance today? Earlier, on the question of perhaps how you'd sort out some of the challenges the country faces, you said those are your own, you know, strategies, plans that then you do not want to reveal to competition. It's up to when you do, if or when you get into power. But what then do you see as your role in governance? Is it just to critique always when something is not working, which is not out of place? Or is there more that as code you could play in as far as governance?
Opposition is government in waiting. Opposition is alternative leadership.
So what alternative leadership are we seeing you offering other than calling out Jubilee when they're seemingly faltering?
You don't seem perhaps to follow what we do and what we say.
Okay.
Remember that as opposition, we do not have the exchequer, we do not have a budget, we do not have taxes, we do not have the police. We don't have an army. Mm-hmm. We don't have the APs, the National Youth Service. That's why you see the obscenities of parading a National Youth Service boys in slums and pretending that they are doing better than the opposition. What can the opposition do? We do not have National Youth Service to deploy. We would deploy them perhaps in a better way.
But they'd argue that Raila, for Kibera's sake, case rather, was their leader for over 2 decades and the cleanup did not happen, that that's what they've been able to do in what, 2 years of their tenure. So there was a time, there were those resources, there was a time he commanded what you're saying that now...
I am talking about opposition.
Yes.
That was
just giving
grand
an example
coalition
of what you have
and
mentioned.
The grand coalition had its own dynamics as well.
Right.
As the opposition, we have alternative ideas, we have alternative way of doing things. For example, when the government brought up recently this security amendment bill, mm-hmm. as the opposition, we read through and very quickly said this is not right. It's a reversal of the gains made in the Bill of Rights under the new constitution. Mm-hmm. It is even attempting to amend the constitution of the Republic of Kenya through municipal legislation, which is a bill brought to parliament. We've said we would not do this if we were the government. Mm-hmm. And we said if the government proceeded to do that, we will challenge it.
Okay.
And we are in court challenging it, and we have won every step of the battle in reversing that law.
Mm.
That is what the opposition should do. When they bring bills to the House and we see that they are not in the interest of the people of Kenya,
mm-hmm.
we give alternative views. they might steamroll the vote because of numbers. Mm-hmm. But that doesn't mean we have not told Kenyans what our alternatives would have been. Look at the issue of resettlement of IDPs born out of the 2007 skirmishes after elections, the violence that followed the elections. Mm-hmm. We have said that the handling of the situation has been flawed.
Okay.
And we have given alternative thinking as to what we should do. Look at the question of land. If I was the president of this country and my family, for historical reasons, had the chunks of land that I see that my brother Uhuru's family has, I honestly can tell you I'll relinquish it to the public.
But how do you do that without standing yourself against your own family? Because it's easier said, but yes. Think about it. And I do not speak for them here.
Yes.
But I remember we had that discussion on Monday, and one of the guests said,
yes,
the challenge becomes how you do that relinquishing, and yet it's not in his name.
I would question how that land was acquired.
Okay, so you'd and get the family to have a conversation.
And I'll sit down with my family and tell them, look, how many are we? How much do we need? Do we need 100,000? 200,000 hectares of land?
Right.
We don't.
We have a call online,
yes,
from the Federation Party of Kenya. Eric, I understand, is joining us. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Sophia.
Go ahead with your contribution.
Yes, I am the Executive Director of Federal Party of Kenya.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. First and foremost, I would like to take this opportunity to congratulate the core principal, Senator Moses Wetangula, for his eloquent articulation of issues.
Thank you.
Yes, and then I would like to react to a point he has attributed to Federal Party of Kenya, Senator.
Yes, sir.
I do agree that, like many other parties in this country, especially in the opposition, that we are facing a great challenge from our members of parliament, some of who have become renegades, especially pandering to the whims of the state machinery, lining their pockets from the state, which is ready to dangle carrots at every corner.
I've seen it happen.
We have seen it is happening in ODM, it is happening in many parties, even in Wiper. In Federal Party of Kenya, I would like to state for the record that we are family in court. We believe in the aspirations and share in the belief that this country has to be offered able leadership, which is not happening at this moment.
I'm relieved to hear that, my brother, and thank you so much.
All right, sir.
Yes.
Hello. Yeah, you're done with the contribution. We need to move on. Our time is up. All right, Eric, I think is, so your thoughts on what you're saying?
Well, he's vindicating what I said,
yeah,
that Federal Party is an affiliate, in fact, is a member of the CORD coalition.
Mm.
And when we went to the Senate, the first official act by the only senator they brought to the Senate was an act of betrayal.
Mm.
Yes, and he's confirmed it.
All right. As we wrap up for a while, the country was treated to a relationship between the National Assembly and the Senate that faced quite a number of turbulent times. I understand you're in court on one of these issues. Talk to us about the state of that and engagement between the Senate and the National Assembly.
We start off from the constitutional structures of the two houses. In many jurisdictions, if not in all jurisdictions that I know, the Senate is normally the upper house, is the appellate chamber, and is the house of last stop, as it were. The design of our constitution is not in that fashion,
mm-hmm,
but it still has structures, provisions, and guarantees that require a symbiotic relationship between the two houses, interdependent and working in harmony towards a common goal for the nation.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we have Article 110(3) of the constitution that requires that before any bill regardless, is tabled for first reading in any house, it must be placed before the two speakers to determine whether it's a money bill, a special bill, or a bill concerning counties,
mm-hmm,
and so on. That then will determine whether the bill will end up at the National Assembly or will move from the National Assembly to the Senate. But from the Senate, every bill ends up at the National Assembly.
Right.
Now, this is something that we in the Senate have been very committed to. As a leadership, we have encouraged our speaker that this must be done and done all the time. I can't say the same of the National Assembly because unilateral decisions have been taken and we ended up in court, if you remember, in the mm-hmm. Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. And when it came to the last contentious bill that is in court today, the securities bill, again we saw the same underhand currents and mischief at play. The matter is in court and one of the challenges is that there was no consultation, so I don't need to delve into this. But I see a situation where the Jubilee structures are encroaching on my speaker, who has been very level-headed and independent, to start playing their game, and I want to encourage him from this forum that he should remain steady and defend the institution of the Senate as he has always done, knowing that we have a very bipartisan approach to issues in the Senate that have brought us together. That's why when we were even debating the special sitting motion on the bill, we did not degenerate into fist fights and other name-calling activities in the Senate.
Okay.
The Senate showed tremendous maturity and respect for the institution of the Senate and Parliament.
All right.
I want to see a situation where both Speaker Muturi and Speaker Ekwe Thuru, both of them are people I know very well. Muturi was my classmate. Ekwe is my close friend. He served two terms in my party before he moved on to another party. That they should have the interest and the future of this country at heart, away from the day-to-day sweeteners and trappings that may come their way to make them subvert the process of fair legislation, because this country looks forward to precedent setting that will help us in the future,
in
other
future.
Than short, quick fixes for convenience of the politics of the day that is not helpful.
All right, Senator, our time is up, but before we go, in the event 2017, your name is not on the presidential ballot, will you seek to defend your Senate seat, or are you going to set your sights elsewhere?
That is a prediction that I don't want to
even
engage
think
in.
About.
I want to become the president of Kenya.
Okay.
And I'm working on becoming the president of Kenya. As and when we reach that bridge, we'll cross it. And like I told you, we have a mechanism in which we believe as code, one, we'll hold together, mm-hmm. two, we will remain strong, three, we will expand our strength, four, and more importantly, we will have a fair, open, democratic, and just arrival of a presidential candidate.
All right.
I hope it will be me. I'm sure my brothers hope they'll be
the ones.
The ones.
Okay.
Whichever way, we must, as code, know that this country is bigger than any one of us, than any single party.
All right. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Pleasure to have you with us on Thank Morning Express.
Thank you so much. Yes.
With us this morning on the Person of Interest, CODCO Principal. He's also the Senate Minority Leader. He's the Senator of Bungoma County. He's also the Ford Kenya Party Leader and a prominent lawyer in Kenya. So delighted to have him with us. Of course, answering also some of the questions you sent through. We thank you for staying with us.